just to know.
Hi people, very very warm welcome to the session. Let's get started with our first session on nationalism in India. I am Ankana, your master teacher for social sciences at Vedanta, hoping all of you are doing absolutely amazing and fine. People, what's up? Quickly tell me, how are my dear bachchas doing? Hi Krishna Ravi, yes I do remember you. Jessica, hi Anushka, hi everyone. Welcome to the session. Guys, just give me a minute. I need to connect my phone to the Wi-Fi because I'm not able to follow your chats regularly. Okay, people, let's get started. How are you feeling? I know people were after my life. Ma'am, when will you finish history? Ma'am, when will you finish history? Ma'am has come with history session, guys. What's up? Hi, Gauri. Hi, Manya. Vishad, taking your name. Welcome to the session. Anjali, Pradeep, Krutika, Vanu. So sweet of you. Thank you, Aksa. Hello, Archana, Ajay. Will both get postponed? So as per the news, there are talks going around it. We still do not know. There's nothing certain. No one can say whether yes or no. Hi Pranav. Hi Suresh. Hi everyone. Hi bachcha log. Hi Harish. Hi. Hi Harjishan. Hi everyone. Pranav, welcome to the session. Guys, are you excited? PDF of the session will be available after 24 hours. Don't worry. 24 ghante mein aapko PDF mil jayega. You will get the PDF within 24 hours. Theek hai? Krishna Ravi, I'll try my best to speak as much English as I can. Though I usually keep switching in English and Hindi. But just in case if you're facing problem, I will definitely speak in English. Okay? What about syllabus reduction? Doesn't seem like syllabus reduction will happen anymore. As of now, this is it. Chalo guys, let's quickly get started. Do you want to join us? Yes or no? Students? Yes or no? I am sure that's a yes. Guys, the good news is available for you. Unlimited live classes with a lot of fun and high level quizzes where you can compete with the students throughout the world. TK globalization. And then of course, interactive replays. Just in case you miss on any session, you will have replays. But the best part is that they're going to be interactive, which means live quizzes. You can actually play the quizzes just like you play it in a live session with leaderboards. That's the fun part. Then you have all of the premium content that the teachers used to teach you, which is downloadable for you. You can download it with handwritten notes of the master teacher. Okay. And then of course, in-class doubt solving and quality tests and assignments, both master teacher and class teacher. There's a class teacher dedicated for the purpose of solving your doubts, who will ensure that all your doubts are sorted right in the session itself, with access to all the micro sessions and crash courses. A lot of students right now are going to subscribe for NTSC. Guys, if you've taken Vedanta Pro subscription, all of this you will get in this one subscription itself. You don't have to access any of the other courses separately. Okay? So what do you understand? Less is more. More number of classes, less amount of money. The link is in the description box, also pinned in the comment section. It's also reflecting in your live chat, and the code is AKEPRO. Please use this code. And if you see, this is the division of the prices. You get you're getting the plans for this price, but actually there's a slight change because of SprintX. We have a special 50% off up to 1500 rupees till 30th of November. 30th November, 25th November se 30th November tak. From 25th of November till 30th of November, you have 50% off. So this is going to come at even lesser price, some 1300 some rupees. And the same goes for this and all this. It is going to cost you way less. Okay. So what else do you want? All of this is going to cost you less than a packet of chips, guys. This is what a Lay's comes for, right? 10 rupees, and it's going to cost you some 10, some 11, 9 and 8 rupees per class. I mean, what else, people? What else do you need? Just go and subscribe. The link is in the description box and the code is AKEPRO. This is the code that will give you access to the discount, okay? Will Sprintex be available? We have started there. I'm not sure of this channel. It's a little difficult to promise. For now, you can start learning from there. Okay, what are you so excited for? The session. Amazing, Harish. I'm really glad. Harish Mohapatra. No, I'm not giving chips. I'm just saying that it's going to cost you less than a chips packet of chips. Okay. Aditya, I'm glad that you guys are liking the Sprintex session. My purpose has been served. Okay guys, so today we're going to get started with introduction and we will finish till non-cooperation movement in tribal areas. How did it look like? Also, please keep watching the Sprintex. I have finished nationalism in India. There were two sessions dedicated. One has been finished today. Another second session is going to come tomorrow. So please make sure that you are watching the Sprintex sessions because important questions from these chapters are going to be there. The first session which has already come has covered till this topic. So it will be very, very relevant for you. Do watch the Sprintex session after this session. It's definitely going to help you. Now, before we begin and we talk about nationalism, what do you mean by nationalism? ठीक है? अभी तो वहीं पे देख लो ना. अभी क्या प्रॉब्लम है? यहाँ आए वहाँ आए, सब तो अभिषेक हम ही हैं, वेदांत तो ये है. क्या फर्क पड़ता है चैनल से? ठीक है? चलो, nationalism. What do you mean by nationalism, guys? Nationalism is actually a feeling. Nationalism is a feeling. Okay, a feeling of association, a feeling of belongingness, a feeling of having a common identity, which people establish with their nation and which people establish with the people of their nation. And when does it establish? What do they need to establish this? They need a common culture. They need some language which binds them together. There is a common history which binds them together. The challenges and struggles are same, right? Challenges and struggles. So these are the things that binds people together, which people associate with, and that is what nationalism is known as, the feeling of association, of identity, of a common identity, right, with the people, with the nation. Okay, of what? Nation and its people. So we are going to talk about how did this feeling arise in the Indians finally when Britishers were there. Guys, as you know, Indians have been very, very different from each other. We have, it's a very diverse country, right? India has always been a very diverse country in terms of culture, language, history, challenges. It's always existed. And earlier, Bangladesh, Pakistan, all of these were also a part of our own country. So the differentiation was huge in terms of diversity. People were very different. So people did not really have this feeling of belongingness and a unique and common identity across. So that was missing. With that, fighting with the Britishers was definitely going to be more and more difficult, right? But there was something that they finally had that gave them the drive, that gave them the inspiration and united them together. Rania, can you tell me what is it? Gaurav? Guys, can you tell me what was that one thing that despite of all of these differences in culture, in language, all of a sudden binded the people together? After civil disobedience movement, but before that itself, struggles, very good. So it was basically the challenges that people started facing, challenges, the oppression, right, the suppression that was happening, that they had to bear. They were being suppressed by Britishers. So all of these things, now the challenges because of the Britishers now binded them together. They had a common struggle against the Britishers. So that is what Actually, modern nationalism is connected to the anti-colonial movement. This is what binded people together. Okay, people after that started realizing that they belong to the same nation. The struggles in the colonial state was similar, and that is how they started relating to each other, because all of them were being oppressed, all of them were being exploited, were being abused. Excessive power, you know, abusing of exploitation of power by Britishers was being executed on all of the citizens. That is what made them relate to each other, and that is how nationalism, the seed of nationalism, finally bloomed in India. Okay, the Congress under Mahatma Gandhi tried to unite different groups together with one movement. So the Congress also, which was being led by Mahatma Gandhi, also trying to do that. They were also trying to unite people. Why? Because Gandhi ji firmly believed that a united firm is very a united and firm front is very, very important in order to throw the Britishers out of the country. Okay, now let's get started with the scenario of First World War. Guys, you know when First World War happened, 1914 to 1918. It was between this year. It started in 1914. Now what happened because of the war? Whenever war happens, what happens in any country? Can you tell me? Jab bhi war hota hai, what happens in a country? Whenever war happens, what will be the scenario in the country? What are certain problems a country is going to face? Gaurav, dates aayenge to tumhe pata chalega na, abhi dates nahi aaye hain. Theek hai? Hi Hiran. Income tax introduced, but in general what happens bachcha? What takes the biggest toll? What gets affected the most with war? Economic destruction. Very good. Any country, okay, it doesn't matter whether it is colonized or not, whether people are participating in the war with their own zeal and will, economic depletion will always happen. The economy will get the maximum hit. Sabse zyada farak, the maximum amount of effect will be on the economy. The same thing happened with First World War with Britain also. See, Britain itself was definitely participating. India and all the other colonized countries were not participating directly. But because these were the colonies of Britain, they had to participate because they were pushed to. As a result of which, what happened? The wealth was completely drained out. Okay, because it was very draining economically and financially, right? Shreya, Suchitra, Athira, welcome to the session, guys. Are you enjoying the session? Are you excited? Do give me a thumbs up and do not forget to hit the like button. Okay, now in order to balance this expenditure, this excessive amount of expenditure that was happening because of the war expenses, the government had to take few steps. So naturally, as I told you, government increase in defense expenditure happened. Defense mein expenditure badh gaya tha, the war expenses went high, right? War expenses were very high. How did they compensate for it? So custom duties and taxes were introduced on people of India who had nothing to do with the war, who were already poor. They had to bear the war expenses in forms of taxes. At the same time, people from villages were being forced to supply soldiers, which means all the boys and men were being forced to join the war on behalf of Britain. Kyunki Britain ko ladna tha, because Britain wanted to fight the war because of that. Okay. Okay. Manaswini, that is why Sprintex is there. That is your one way to revise the entire chapter in two sessions, quick sessions. Then at the same time, a very bad hit was taken by the country. The crops failed, as a result of which scarcity of food was there. There was no food for people. So famines and epidemics occurred. Influenza epidemic also occurred. Just like how corona pandemic we have right now. Outbreak of influenza happened in country, as a result of which millions of people, 12 to 13 millions of people died. And the government did nothing because they were completely engrossed in the war. They could have managed this better, guys, but their expenditure was flowing only in fueling the war, not in taking care of their colonies, right? As a result of which, people had to have a very hard time during the war. So naturally, what were the expectations? If people were having a hard time during the war, what do you think were their expectations now? Sunita? Rania, census of 1921, what do you think? No, Srijani, over there I take long-term English, okay? Guys, what were the general expectations of people? Sunita, because on this channel I have not taught this chapter, that is why, okay? Yes. They were expecting that their hardships would end after the war. People were expecting that whatever problems that they're having right now will be over once the war is over. But they were absolutely wrong. They were proven wrong by the government. It happened the opposite way. Instead of the situation improving, the situation in fact degraded further. Now the entire society, the entire country was on a downfall. They were having a very, very difficult time. Now who was required? We needed a savior. We needed a hero to save us. And a hero, a magician, came from South Africa and saved us and rescued us. At this stage, a new leader appeared and suggested a new mode of struggle. Who was this exactly? Very good, Manaswini. Absolutely right, guys. Who was it? It was Mahatma Gandhi. So he came with the idea of Satyagraha. Guys, when Mahatma Gandhi was in South Africa, he had already implemented the idea of Satyagraha over there, and it had been a complete and it had had complete success. It had been very, very successful over there. So he came with this idea of Satyagraha in India. He returned back in January 1915 with this idea. Now, what was Satyagraha? Satya means truth and agraha basically means a polite persuasion, okay, or you could say request. So he said that if you are on the right side, if you are truthful, if you are holding the weapon of truth in your hand, no one can suppress you, no one can oppress you. The oppressor will ultimately realize his mistake on his own. The violence and force is not required in order to do that. Okay, so he emphasized on the power of truth and the need of the search for truth. He said that you keep on looking for your truth, the oppressor is going to believe in your truth automatically and give up all of this exploitation that he is doing on you. There is no one behind me. It's just me here. Okay, Aran. So it doesn't believe in physical force, right? Satyagraha did not believe in physical force to fight oppressors against justice. It was an absolutely non-violent movement. This was a big feature of all the movements that was launched by Gandhiji, that it was a non-violent movement, guys. Okay? So how did he start it? He presented a cake to the Britishers. Okay, presented a cake to the Britishers. He said, I have come back from South Africa. I have brought a present for you. Why don't you taste this cake? Now, what was this cake? This cake was in form of Champaran, Ahmedabad and Kheda. So let's start with the discussion of how did he start the Satyagraha. But it started in Champaran in Bihar in year 1916, where the peasants were suffering, right? It was against the oppressive plantation system for the peasants. Peasants were being, oppressed. Revenue, plantation. You would see different rules were implemented on them. People did not want to work over there. They were forced to grow indigo, which was making their land infertile, and they were not even being compensated wisely. So they were in a lot of economic crisis. Okay, on top of it, revenues were being imposed on them. So there was an economic crisis that the peasants in Bihar were going through. So he started from here, the beginning of this movement. Then he went to Kheda in Gujarat in year 1917, where again he supported the peasants during the crop failure. If crop failure has happened, they wouldn't have money, right? It will result in no money. So what will be the result of this? No revenue would be paid, right? How will they pay their revenue? It would be very difficult for them. So that was the problem. They were being forced to pay the revenue, and that too high in amount. So demand for the relaxation in revenue collection is what he supported over here in Kheda, Gujarat. And then he moved to Ahmedabad, where he organized Satyagraha movement along with the cotton mill workers. So there were a lot of mills over here, textile mills. Over here, the workers were being exploited. They were not being paid proper wages as per the time they were, spending over there, the amount of work that they were doing. The working conditions were not good. Working conditions were also very bad. Were very bad. So they needed some improvisation. So that is what he helped in. Okay, that is what Mahatma Gandhi helped the peasants in, and that was the cake, guys, that he gave to the Britishers, right? So Chitra Sumukha. Yes. Okay, so with that started Satyagraha, but then how did it came to non-cooperation movement? NCM, where did NCM, non-cooperation movement, came from? So the roots of it was established, the seeds of it was sowed with the Rowlatt Act. What was Rowlatt Act, Bachcha? It was an act which gave immense and enormous power to the Britishers in 1919. So in 1919, the Imperial Legislative Council of Britishers passed a law, passed an act. Under this act, the policemen, the authority of the Britishers, which was basically the Britishers, had an enormous power. What was this power? This power basically allowed them to detain the political prisoners without trial for 2 years. For 2 years, they did not even have to take the people through trial, and they could imprison them, they could detain them for 2 years. And the whole idea was actually to suppress the protests. But this was not right, because this was abuse of power, and that's what the authorities were doing. They were anyways abusing the power. On top of it, this gave them enormous flexibility to do it further. Even if they wanted to oppress the protest, even if they wanted to suppress the protest, this was not the right way to do it, right? Hello Priya, Archana. So, bachche, we see that Rowlatt Act was passed by the Imperial Legislative Council in order to curb the protests and in order to limit and cut off the hands and legs of the protesters, of the political protesters, activists of India who were asking for freedom. Okay, this gave the authorities enormous power to detain anyone they felt has done some wrong without any trial, without any charge sheet, nothing, and detain them for not just few days but for 2 years. Normally, if anyone does a mistake, what happens? Bacha, Rishika, Arshibi, Risha, what happens to that person? Palak, thank you so much. Danish, Abhinava, Arshibi, what happens if a person does a mistake? What do you do to that person? Normally, what is the right thing to do? Niharika, you're already going. Shri Kumar, hello. Miku, Bacha, we arrest them. A proper trial happens. The person is taken to the court, and then the judge passes a judgment whether the person is at wrong or not, whether the person is a culprit or not. But under this act, none of this was required for the first 2 years. As a result of which, a lot of protests started. People started protesting. People came on roads, and these were basically peaceful protests. It's not like it were violent protests. And the same thing happened on 13th April in 1999, where people in Jallianwala Bagh were also protesting. Few of the people were having a very peaceful protest, and there were few who were there to attend the Baisakhi fair without even being aware of the protest going on over there. There were people of all the ages, children, old men, all of them. And completely aware of the Martial Act that was being imposed by General Dyer. General Dyer had imposed a Martial Act, which was basically an act imposed over citizens during a time of emergency, which takes away their power of protesting, of expression, and all of these things. These guys were unaware of it and were having a very peaceful protest against the Rowlatt Act. Now, what did General Dyer do? He was absolutely angry and very, very agitated over the fact that how could Indians dare to protest against the Britishers. So he entered into this covered place of Jallianwala Bagh, which had only few entrances or maybe one entrance, and blocked the entrances and ordered his people for open fire. And more than hundreds of people of all ages, children, women, everyone died in that incident. Now, it was highly condemned by everyone. It was not at all right for them to do it. Niharika, good night. No, bacha, I am not married. No, it's not a premiered session. It is a live session. Okay. So there were strikes and clashes with police and attacks on government buildings. In reaction to this, government also responded with brutal repression. Seeing the violence that was spreading, Mahatma Gandhi called off the movement. He said Satyagraha will not work like that because it is a non-violent movement. It is about the power of truth, and that power of truth was failing over here. Yes, shame, dire shame. Jannat, hello, Mickey. So Gandhi ji realized two things. One, that it had, people over here were not ready for mass movements. That's a continuous realization. So, but before that, he realized the very first thing, number one, that Hindus and Muslims cannot be separated. He realized that united front had to be presented in front of the Britishers if we had to be strong in front of them, so that they could not divide and rule us, okay, to avoid this. So he came up with a plan to include the Muslims also into this movement. And how did he do this? Exactly, with the Khilafat movement. Very good. So Khilafat issue was very hot at this point, guys. So the Khalifa, which is the head of the Muslims, okay, was being removed after the Ottoman Empire's decline, okay. And Muslims were highly condemning this, and they were not at all in favor of this, and they were protesting against it. So a Muslim League was being formed. It was a Khilafat issue was being raised. So it was to defend the Khalifa's temporal power. It took the shape of a united mass action by the Muslims, moreover, to protect the Khalifa's power. Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali were the leaders of this. So he picked up the right, very hot discussion and movement that was going at that time. And he combined his workforce power with Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali, the Ali brothers who were leading the Khilafat movement. So Gandhi ji brought them in, and then in Calcutta session of 1920, he declared the Khilafat and Swaraj together. Together the Khilafat started with Swaraj, which means our own. Swaraj means own independent Raj country. Okay, so Chitra, what have I not replied to? Hi, Reema. Pooja Barrett, hello. Sumbuka Surya, hi. Akansha Yadav, hi guys. Dazzling Glamour, yes, Khilafat issue was of great importance because this was the point where the Muslims were going to be united with the Hindus, right? And Gandhi ji used his brain like anything. He was a very smart person. He knew where to hit and how to hit it. Okay, then after that he started the Swaraj movement. Then why non-cooperation? Bachcha, he had in his Hind Swaraj, the book that he wrote in 1909, he had clearly said that Britishers would have not been able to survive in India if the Indians would have not cooperated with them. They were only able to survive for hundreds of years in India because they were getting cooperated by the Indians. So he started the non-cooperation movement, wherein he said to Indians that do not cooperate with Britishers, do not participate with them in anything, do not help them in anything. They wouldn't be able to last even for 6 months in the country without Indians. Cooperations, right? Without Indians. So he started the non-cooperation movement. Now this movement was going to unfold in stages. It was not a movement which just started and was going to end immediately. It was going to be a step-by-step process. So he started by saying that people who are working for the Britishers should first surrender their titles. Whoever were in the police, government jobs, they should give up their offices, right? So people should give up their offices and the titles. People should give up the titles and the honors that were given to them by the Britishers, right? And also the powers that came along with it. Whatever was given to them by Britishers should be given up. Then after that, people should not work for the government offices. No one should work for the, should work for the British government, because in India they were taking the help of Indians only to run the government. If Indians were not there, how would they work it? Okay, so army, police, courts, legislative council, schools, foreign goods, all of these things were to be boycotted, were to be given up. What do we mean by boycotted? I will tell you in a minute. But there was one problem, guys. Government Act of India was passed, under which basically the Indians were allowed now to participate in elections. So Congress leaders were a little reluctant because they wanted to participate in the elections that were scheduled for November 1920. But Gandhiji kind of, you know, made them understand, convinced them, and after much negotiation from Gandhiji, non-cooperation program was adopted in Nagpur session of Indian National Congress in December 1920. Okay, so this is how it was happening. Boycott means the refusal to deal and associate with people or participate in activities or buy and use things, usually from protest. So that is what happened. Now we are going to understand how different people perceive the difference in national cooperation movement. Everyone, guys, all the sectors of the society had a different perception, had a different expectation out of non-cooperation movement. If we talk about the middle class, so out of cities, the major chunk of people who participated in the NCM was of the middle class people. Students left their schools, universities, teachers resigned, and lawyers gave up their legal practices. Except for Madras, the council elections were boycotted in most of the provinces, which was to be happening in November 1920. 100 years back, exactly 100 years back. Right. Now, why did Madras not give up? Because over there, they were completely convinced. So guys, they were not only religious, they were not only communal differences, there were caste differences also, which has pertained always in our society. So these guys were, the backward sections were always dominated. Hi, Amit Jha. Hi, Bachche. They were always dominated by the Brahmin sections. So they came up with the solution that if they wanted to stop this domination, they had to come into political power. They have to get empowered by being in the political offices. So they said that they have to fight against this discrimination, and for that they cannot give up the elections, they have to participate in it. And Gandhiji was not able to convince them. So except for Madras, everyone else boycotted the elections also. Then along with that, British goods were also boycotted, be it the clothes, be it the liquors, everything, right? So from 1921 to 21, the production of Indian textile mills and handlooms went up. Why? Because import of foreign clothes had a decline. It went on a decline because of the boycotting of the foreign clothes. So people in India had started benefiting from that. Foreign goods were boycotted, liquor shops were picketed, which means women sat in front of the shops and did not let the shop owners even open the shop. And foreign clothes were burnt in huge bonfires along with other foreign materials, right? Because they were the higher castes, Rishika, they were the higher caste people, so they were dominating and discriminating against the backward caste people. Okay, Manaswini, Suchitra, nahi lagegi nazar. Okay, but there was a problem with this. Foreign goods were definitely, boycotted. Foreign goods were boycotted, textiles, everything. But there was no proper alternative. Alternative was not good enough. Right? Sorry. Oh my God, what have I written? One second, I will just erase that for you people. Yeah, so alternative, guys, was not good enough. Why? There were no proper schools and colleges that people could go to after boycotting their schools and colleges, right? Teachers did not have alternatives. Lawyers did not have any alternatives. Then the alternative to imported goods and textiles were khadi. But khadi, the manufacturing one, was very time taking. Plus it was very, very expensive. The Maharashtrian women had to wear nawari, which was a 9 meter long sari. And a 9 meter long sari would cost a lot of money, which was not affordable for people, right? So khadi cloth was often more expensive, which means not affordable by people, right? So that was a problem. Lack of alternative Indian institutions. There were no schools or colleges where people could go. Kahan jaate log? Where people would have gone. Students and teachers, as a result of this, started going back to the government schools and institutions, and lawyers also joined back their work again. Okay. Bacha, it was started in the, I have just told you, it started with Swaraj. Okay, now non-cooperation in the countryside. Bacha, countryside basically towards the villages. Countryside as in the villages. Okay, now over here, peasants were led by Baba Ramchandra. Okay, the movement here was against the talukdars and landlords. Landlords were exploiting these people with revenues. Okay, with tax, you could say no proper employment, all of these issues was there. There was begar, which means work was being done without wages, without proper wages. They were not being compensated properly. No security of tenure. How long are they being hired for? Sometimes they're being hired, sometimes they're being fired. It was very, very difficult for them, and of course high rents on top of it and revenues. So the fight over here in Awadh was against the talukdars and the landlords. The dhobis, as a result of this, what they did, the nais, the dhobis, the people who used to do the basic work of for the high class people. Guys, remember, high class people were mostly supportive of Britishers, and even the Britishers had low class people of the society, the poor people who were working for them. What they did was they gave up their jobs and they stopped working for the landlords. Okay. So as a result of this, they had no one to work for them. Nai, dhobi, buns were there, organized by panchayats to deprive the landlords of services. Even the barbers and the washermen said, we are not going to wash your clothes, we are not going to cut your hair, we are not going to do anything that you have to do. Now they had no one to work for them. In June 1920, Jawaharlal Nehru joined the movement. Along with Baba Ramchandra, he established Awadh Kisan Sabha. Within a month, over 300 branches had been set up in villages around the region and few in cities also. Okay, Bacha, I told you it started because Gandhiji said that only with the cooperation of Indians, Britishers have been able to last for so long in India. If the people of India start not if they stop cooperating with them, then they will not be able to survive over here. Okay. Now, what was the problem with this in countryside? What were the challenges that they had to face on countryside? See, The main idea was that the plan, the idea, like the movement was supposed to be non-violent. So first, when they gave up their services order to be a part of the movement, was fine. But later on, what they started doing was they started attacking the talukdars and the merchants in their houses itself. They were beaten, they were looted, and this is what had started giving it a violent face. The bazaars were looted and grains were hoarded. The grains hoarded were taken over. So guys, they did not have enough food. So people started saying that Gandhiji is saying that you have to fight for your right. You have to stop working for these people and go ahead and loot over whatever they have. So the grains and everything were being looted by everyone. The local leaders told peasants Gandhiji had declared no taxes were to be paid and land was to be redistributed among the poor. So this is what people started fighting for. You can see that there was a misinterpretation and a miscommunication in the name of Gandhiji, which has started tainting Gandhi's name and the non-cooperation movement over here in the countryside. Now let's see what happened in the tribal areas. So bacha, in Gudem Hills of Andhra Pradesh, the militant guerrilla movement was going on, which spread a lot in 1920. Now what is guerrilla movement? So this is a tactics that was used by early kings when they did not used to have enough men in their army, and they did not have enough soldier. Whenever an enemy would come, they would hide in the branches of the tree and they would attack them without them being informed, not from front but with a surprise, basically shock more than that, and as a result of which they would kill them. So this had started happening with the Britishers now, and that become very, very common across in this part of Andhra Pradesh. British had restricted the entry of the tribals in the forests. That was another reason why they were doing this. Now you might be thinking that why did it matter so much if they were not allowed to enter into the forest? Because bacha, the life of the tribals is completely dependent on forests. See, tribals have always lived in forests. Their livelihood depends on forests. Okay, whatever they work is around forest. At the same time, it has a huge cultural and traditional value. So they have to stay in the forest. But the Britishers did not understand this and restricted the entry of the tribals whose whole life is centered in the forest into the forest. As a result of which, they started attacking the Britishers. They would hide in the trees and would attack them with the guerrilla movement. Okay. Then they had a leader called Alluri Sitaram Raju who emerged as a leader. He was a great follower of Gandhiji. It's not like he was not. Okay. He was a great follower of Gandhiji, but he was a great influencer for the people over here. Okay. Influencer for people. But what he had started doing was he had started saying that he has supernatural powers. If you fire on him, the bullet will not enter his body. The rebels proclaimed that he was an incarnation of God. So you can see such things were being said by him. He persuaded people to wear khadi. So whatever Gandhiji said, and give up drinking, which was very good, which was absolutely aligned with NCM. But he said that violence is supposed to be used, not a part of NCM. As a result of which, he became a target for the British police and he was ultimately killed by them. The Gudem rebels attacked police stations, tried to kill British officials and carried on guerrilla warfare for achieving Swaraj, which was a complete failure of national non-cooperation movement, because that was not at all the idea of non-cooperation movement, right, Shruti? No, bacha, a second phase has been completed, yes. Of national movement, I think so. I'm not able to recall. I think so. Kya hua Rishika? Nahi to kya time out? I can see your comment. Okay. So guys, with this, we are done with today's session. I will tell you about what was happening in the rest of the part of the country in the next session with the plantation workers and everyone else. Okay, so as you know, that amazing result has been given out by the students of Vedant in JEE Advanced, NEET, and 10th-12th. You can also be a part of this. Scholarship tests are going on at 3 a.m. every Sunday from 25th October to 29th November, grade 6 to 13th. You can win scholarship up to rupees 100 crore, worth 100 crore rupees, and 100% of scholarship. Make sure to appear for this test. Also, enrollment for JEE and NEET repeaters batch has started. Make sure to enroll. Let's quickly look at your homework question. Which class was mainly involved initially in the non-cooperation Khilafat movement? Royal class, middle class, lower class, or all of the above? And with this, we have come to the end of the session. Guys, do not forget to like the video. Make sure to put your doubts in the comment section. And also, do tell me how did you like the video and your answers in the comment section, because that is where I will be picking up the answers for my leaderboard in the next session. So make sure to put your answers over there, and I will see you guys in the next session. People, have a good night. Take good care of yourself. Bye everyone. See you soon. Bye people. Good night.